You're listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper.
And I'm Carolyn Nelson.
And I'm Carolyn Nelson.
Boy, oh boy, you're going to smack me good, aren't you? Forgot to turn up your pot there. Okay, folks, make sure you've got a big, thick pad of paper by your side and a pen. And get ready for the next of the series on treason. This is hour number 11 of our treason series. And this one is going to open your eyes, and you're going to understand that we've been screwed, blued, and tattooed for a long, long time, ladies and gentlemen. First, I want to straighten out something that I may have said in error on the earlier show. I want to get that straight right now. Those of you who want to get this ultimate weapon that we're talking about that would help to repel an invasion and occupation of enemy forces who would want to take over the United States of America in defense of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. The proper weapon to get is a .375 H&H Magnum, but it must have a Mauser action. It must have a Mauser action. I think I left that out in the earlier broadcast, and if you don't have a Mauser action, you're going to have problems, because what we're going to do is take that .375 H&H Magnum cartridge, and you're going to learn on Monday night how to create 25% more area inside that cartridge, which we're going to fill with powder. So, folks, make sure you get a Mauser action. It's the only one strong enough to withstand this kind of a modification to a round that's already one of the big game rounds of the world. So, remember, you need a .375 H&H Magnum. It must have a Mauser action, and it has to have the longest barrel that you can find. Okay? Make sure that you purchase it from someone who has a reputation for making accurate firearms. Everything that we're going to do is going to be 100% legal. So don't worry about it. Everything is legal. We don't advise you to do anything illegal on the hour of the time. Remember, the law is with us. We want the law to stay with us. I'm going to bring your attention now to a book that I want you to get. Make sure you get this book. This book was published in 1939 and 1940 by H.G. Wells. 1939 and 1940 by H.G. Wells. Guess what the name of the book is, folks? 1939 and 1940 by H.G. Wells. The name of the book is, ta-da-ta-da, The New World Order. That's right, The New World Order. And I know that many of you out there thought that George Bush coined that phrase. Here's what it says on the fly leaf of the dust jacket. What will happen to Europe and to the whole world when the present war is ended? There will be a revolution. That's obvious, Mr. Wells says. Following a consideration of those factors which make it inevitable, he concludes that such a revolution must be along socialistic lines if civilization is to survive. But the new world order, which Mr. Wells suggests, must be a world socialism, scientifically planned and directed, with insistence upon law based on a restatement of the rights of man and complete freedom of speech, criticism, and publication. This can be attained, he is convinced, only if each one is equally certain that it can and each will work none now towards realizing it. And no sane man can make a better beginning in that direction than to read this book. The table of contents, ladies and gentlemen, chapter 1 is called The End of an Age. I bet you couldn't guess that after listening to my Mystery Babylon series. The End of an Age, which means it's the beginning of a new age. Remember, this was copyrighted in 1939 and 1940 by H.G. Wells before the war started. He says, what will happen to Europe and to the whole world when the present war is ended? Are you beginning to understand out there, sheeple? I hope so. Chapter 2, Open Conference. Chapter 3, Disruptive Forces. Chapter 4, Class War. Chapter 5, Unsated Youth. Bring anything to mind? Chapter 6, Socialism Unavoidable. Chapter 7, Federation. Chapter 8, The New Type of Revolution. Chapter 9, Politics for the Sane Man. Chapter 10, Declaration of the Rights of Man. Chapter 11, International Politics. Chapter 12, World Order in Being. Sometimes I wish they'd let me cuss on radio. Oh, boy, I could just cuss a blue streak over some of this stuff. Isn't it fun, folks? Okay, don't go away. We got a lot of things to talk about. You got a lot of numbers and report numbers and laws and executive orders and U.S. codes and congressional record references that you're going to need to write down, because you're all going to have to go and look this stuff up. And if you don't, then you'll never know whether I'm lying to you or not. And if you just go with it without checking it out, that means you cease to be their puppet on their string, and now you're my puppet on my string.
A long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made me shiver with every paper I deliver. Bad news on the doorstep, I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride. Something touched me deep inside today. The music died. So bye-bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. And then good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, this'll be the day that I die.
Yes. Everybody write down Senate Report Number 93-549. 93rd Congress, first session, 1973. That's Senate Report Number 93-549, 93rd Congress, first session, 1973. I'm going to say it one more time. Senate Report Number 93-549, 93rd Congress, first session, 1973. The title is Summary of Emergency Power Statutes. It's the Summary of Emergency Power Statutes. It consists of 607 pages, ladies and gentlemen, which I think you will find most interesting. You see, the United States went bankrupt in 1933 and was declared so by President Roosevelt by Executive Orders Number 6073, 6102, 6111 and by Executive Order 6260 on March the 9th, 1933. The Executive Order 6073, 6102, 6111, and by Executive Order 6260 on March 9th, 1933. Also see Senate Report 93-549, pages 187 and 594. Under the Trading with the Enemy Act. That's the Trading with the Enemy Act. Okay, 65th Congress. That's Trading with the Enemy Act, 65th Congress, Session 1, Chapters 105 and 106, October 6th, 1917. So Trading with the Enemy Act, 65th Congress, Session 1, Chapters 105 and 106, October 6, 1917, and as codified at 12 U.S.C.A. 95A, that's 12 U.S.C.A. 95A, on May 23, 1933. Congressman Louis T. McFadden brought formal charges against the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve Bank System, the Comptroller of the Currency, and the Secretary of the United States Treasury for criminal acts. The petition for articles of impeachment was thereafter referred to the Judiciary Committee and has yet to be acted upon, and the traitors in Congress know about it and are sitting on it and have been sitting on it from that date until this. See the Congressional Record, pages 4055 and 4058. Congress confirmed the bankruptcy on June the 5th, 1933, and impaired the obligations and considerations of contracts through the joint resolution to suspend the gold standard and abrogate the gold clause, June 5th, 1933. See House Joint Resolution 192, 73rd Congress, First Session. The several states of the Union pledged the faith and credit thereof to the aid of the national government, and formed numerous socialist committees, such as the Council of State Governments, Social Security Administration, and many others. And these were to purportedly deal with the economic emergency. These organizations operated, ladies and gentlemen, on something that you thought just came about, but that's not true. Operated under the Declaration of Interdependence. The Declaration of Interdependence of January the 22nd, 1937, and published some of their activities in the Book of the States. The 1937 edition of the Book of the States openly declared that the people engaged in such activities as the farming, husbandry industry had been reduced to mere feudal tenants on their land. Refer to the Book of the States, 1937, page 155. This, of course, was compounded by such activities as price fixing, wheat and grains, 7 U.S.C.A. 1332, quota regulations, 7 U.S.C.A. 1371, and livestock products, 7 U.S.C.A. 1903, which have been consistently below the costs of production. Interest on loans and inflation of the paper bills of credit, leaving the food producers and others in a state of peonage and involuntary servitude, constituting the taking of private property for the benefit and use of others without just compensation against the Constitution. Now, the Council of State Governments has now been absorbed into such things as the National Conference of Commissioners on Uniform State Laws, whose headquarters office is located at 676 North Street. It's 676 North St. Clair Street, Suite 1700, Chicago, Illinois, 60611. That's 676 North St. Clair Street, Suite 1700, Chicago, Illinois, 60611. and all being members of the bar and operating under a different constitution and bylaws, far distant from the depositories of the public records, has promulgated, lobbied for, passed, adjudicated, and ordered the implementation and execution of their purported uniform and model acts and pretended statutory provisions to help implement international treaties of the United States are where world uniformity would be desirable. See the 1990 and 1991 reference book, National Council of Commissioners on Uniform State Laws, page 2. This is apparently what Robert Bork meant when he wrote, quote, "We are governed not by law or elected representatives, but by an unelected, unrepresentative, unaccountable committee of lawyers applying no will but their own," unquote. All, ladies and gentlemen, Freemasons. See The Tempting of America by Robert H. Bork, page 130. This association has been engaged in activities such as turning marriage licenses into international private law through its international liaisons, which meet at such places as the Hague Conferences. See the Handbook of Commissioners on Uniform State Laws, 1966 edition, pages 156 and 157. On April 25, 1938, the Supreme Court overturned this standing precedent of the prior 150 years concerning common law in the federal government and said this, quote, "There is no federal common law, and Congress has no power to declare substantive rules of common law applicable in a state, whether they be local or general in their nature, be they commercial law or a part of the law of torts," unquote. See the case, Erie Railroad Company versus Tompkins, 304, United States, 64, 80, 82nd, L.Ed., 1188. The common law is the fountain source of substantive and remedial rights, if not our very liberties. For that, see Stephen A., Treatise on the Principles of Pleading, Stephen A., Treatise on the Principles of Pleading, Introduction, page 23, and Hemingway, History of Common Law Pleading as Evidence of the Growth of Individual Liberty and Power of the Courts, 5 Alabama Law Journal, 1 Swift versus Tyson, 16 Peters 1, 10 L. Ed. 865, The Constitution, Article 3, Section 2, and Amendments 7, 9, and 10. You want some more homework? Told you, folks, this is treason, and it's all documented, and anybody can find it. The members and association of the bar thereafter formed committees, granted themselves special privileges, immunities, and franchises, and held meetings concerning the judicial procedures, and further, to amend laws to conform to a trend of judicial decisions, are to accomplish similar objectives, including hodgepodging the jurisdictions of law and equity together, which is known today as one form of action. See the Constitution and Bylaws, Article 3, Section 3.3C, 1990-91, reference book, Supra. See also Colorado Methods of Practice, or Western Publications, Volume 4, or West Publications, Volume 4, pages 2 and 3, for the author's comments. The enumerated, specific, and distinct jurisdictions established by the ordained Constitution in 1789, Article 3, Section 2, and under the Bill of Rights, 1791, Amendment 7, were further hodgepodged and fundamentally changed in 1982 to include Admiralty jurisdiction, which was once again brought inland. Quote, "This is the fundamental change necessary to effect unification of civil and admiralty procedure, just as the 1938 rules abolished the distinction between actions at law and suits in equity. This change would abolish the distinction between civil actions and suits in admiralty." Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, 1982 edition, page 17. Also see the Federalist Papers, number 83. The Declaration of Resolves of the First Continental Congress, October 14, 1774. The Declaration of Cause and Necessity of Taking Up Arms, July 6, 1775. The Declaration of Independence, July 4th, 1776. Bennett versus Butterworth, 52, United States, 669. Well, maybe you better go get a glass of water. I need a drink of coffee, so... Start feeling that little tickle in the back of my throat. Well, whatever that is that we all have, just seems to hang on. The United States, folks, thereafter entered the Second World War, during which time the League of Nations was reinstituted under pretense of the United Nations. Remember, it had already risen and died. Now it was resurrected under the pretense of the United Nations. For that, see 22 U.S.C.A. 287 et sequitur, and the Bank for International Settlements, reinstituted under pretense of the Bretton Woods Agreement. See 60 Statutes 1401 22 U.S.C.A. 286 et sequitur, as the International Monetary Fund. The Fund and the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, the Bank. So you now have the Fund and the Bank. The United States, as a corporate body politic, artificial, came out of World War II in worse economic shape than when it entered, and in 1950 declared bankruptcy and reorganization. The reorganization is located in Title V of United States Codes, annotated. The explanation at the beginning of 5 U.S.C.A. is most informative reading. The Secretary of the Treasury was appointed as the receiver in bankruptcy. See Reorganization Plan number 26, 5 U.S.C.A. 903, Public Law 94-564. Legislative History, pages 59-67. The United States went down the road and periodically filed for further reorganization. Things and situations worsened, having done what they were commanded not to do. For that, see Madison's Notes, Constitutional Convention, August 16, 1787, and Federalist Papers, number 44. And in 1965, passed the Coinage Act of 1965, completely debasing the constitutional coin, gold and silver, in effect dollar. See 18 U.S.C.A. 331 and 332, U.S. versus Marigold, 50 U.S. 560, 13 L.Ed. 257. At the signing of the Coinage Act on July 23, 1965, Lyndon Baines Johnson stated in his press release that, quote, "When I have signed this bill before me, we will have made the first fundamental change in our coinage in 173 years. The Coinage Act of 1965 supersedes the Act of 1792, and that act had the title, An Act Establishing a Mint and Regulating the Coinage of the United States. Now I will sign this bill to make the first change in our coinage system since the 18th century. To those members of Congress who are here on this historic occasion, I want to assure you that in making this change from the 18th century, we have no idea of returning to it," unquote. Now it's important, folks, to take cognizance of the fact that no constitutional amendment was ever obtained to fundamentally change, amend, abridge, or abolish the constitutional mandates, provisions, or prohibitions. But due to internal and external diversions surrounding the Vietnam War, etc., the usurpation and breach went basically unchallenged and unnoticed by the general public at large, who became a wealthy man's cannon fodder, or cheap source of slave labor. Let me say that for you again. The usurpation and breach went basically unchallenged and unnoticed by the general public at large, that's you, who became a wealthy man's cannon fodder or cheap source of slave labor, that's you again. See Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, Chapter 1, Behold a Pale Horse, by William Cooper. Congress was clearly delegated the power and authority to regulate and maintain the true and inherent value of the coin within the scope and purview of Article 1, Section 8, Clauses 5 and 6, and Article 1, Section 10, Clause 1 of the ordained Constitution of 1787, and further, under a corresponding duty and obligation to maintain said gold and silver coin and foreign coin at and within the necessary and proper equal weights and measures clause. See also the Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 25, verses 13 through 16, Proverbs chapter 16, verse 11, and Public Law 97-289 and 96 Statutes 12-11. Those exercising the offices of the several states in equal measure knew such de facto transitions were unlawful and unauthorized, unconstitutional, but sanctioned, implemented, and enforced the complete debauchment and the resulting governmental, social, industrial, economic change in the de jure states and in United States of America. See Public Law 94-564, Legislative History, page 5936 and 5945, 31 U.S.C.A. 314, 31 U.S.C.A. 321, 31 U.S.C.A. 5112, CRS 1161-101, CRS 3922-103.5, and CRS 1811-203, and were and are now under the delusion that they can do both directly and indirectly what they were absolutely prohibited from doing. See also the Federalist Papers, number 44, Craig versus Missouri, and 4 Peters, 903. In 1966, ladies and gentlemen, Congress began severely compromised, passed the Federal Tax Lien Act of 1966, by which the entire taxing and monetary system, in effect, the essential engine, see the Federalist Papers, number 31, and Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, Behold a Pale Horse, Chapter 1, and was placed under the Uniform Commercial Code. See Public Law 89-719, Legislative History, pages 3722. Also, see CRS 51106. The Uniform Commercial Code was, of course, promulgated by the National Conference of Commissioners on Uniform State Laws in collusion with American Law Institute for the, quote, banking and business interests, unquote. See the Handbook of the National Conference of Commissioners on Uniform State Laws, 1966 edition, pages 152 and 153. The United States, being engaged in numerous United Nations conflicts, including the Korean and the Vietnam conflicts, which were under direction of the United Nations, see 22 U.S.C.A. 287-D, and agreeing to foot the bill, see 22 U.S.C.A. 287-J, and not being able to honor their obligations, and rehypothecated debt credit, openly and publicly, dishonored and disavowed their notes and obligations. 12 U.S.C.A. 411, in effect, Federal Reserve notes through Public Law 90-269, Section 2, 82 Statutes at Large 50, 1968, to wit. Quote, Section 2. The first sentence of Section 15 of the Federal Reserve Act, 12 U.S.C. 391, is amended by striking, quote, and the funds provided in this act for the redemption of Federal Reserve notes, unquote. Things steadily grew worse. And on March 28, 1970, President Nixon issued Proclamation No. 3972, declaring an emergency because the postal employees struck against the de facto government for higher pay due to inflation of the paper bills of credit. See Senate Report number 93-549, page 596. Nixon then placed the United States Postal Department under control of the Department of Defense. See the Department of the Army Field Manual, FM 41-10, 1969 edition. The system had been faltering for a decade, but the benchmark date of the collapse is put at August 15, 1971. On this day, President Nixon reversed United States international monetary policy by officially declaring the non-convertibility of the United States dollar or Federal Reserve note into gold. See Public Law 94-564, Legislative History, page 5937, and Senate Report number 93-549. Forward on page 3. My tongue is getting tied around my iTunes, folks. Let me say that again so that no one gets confused. See Public Law 94-564, Legislative History, page 5937, and Senate Report number 93-549, forward, page 3, Proclamation number 4074, page 597, 31 U.S.C.A. 314 and 31 U.S.C.A. 5112. On September 21st, 1973, Congress passed Public Law 93-1. This one-hour commercial for Swiss America Trading is brought to you by the United States de facto counterfeit government sitting in Washington, D.C., populated by traders. For the quickest way out, call Swiss America Trading at 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Do it now, folks. If everybody in this country would just convert their worthless Federal Reserve notes into gold or silver coin and use nothing less than gold or silver coin and accept nothing less than gold or silver coin, all the traitors and the treason and the New World Order would be rendered bankrupt, ineffective, and it would be all over. But of course, we know that nobody's going to do that. Except the smart ones. Call now, 1-800-289-2646. That's 1-800-289-2646. Thank them for sponsoring this program. You'll be glad that you did. Thank you. See Public Law 94-564, Legislative History, page 5937. And Senate Report number 93-549, forward, page 3, Proclamation number 4074, page 597, 31 U.S.C.A. 314 and 31 U.S.C.A. 5112. On September 21st, 1973, Congress passed Public Law 93-110, amending the Bretton Woods Par Value Modification Act, 82 Statutes 116, 31 U.S.C.A. 449, and reiterated the emergency under 12 U.S.C.A. 95A and Section 8 of the Bretton Woods Agreements Act of 1945, 22 U.S.C.A. 286F, and which included reports on foreign currency transactions. See also Executive Order number 10033. This act further declared in Section 2B that, quote, no provision of any law, in effect, on the date of enactment of this act, and no rule, regulation, or order under authority of any such law may be construed to prohibit any person from purchasing, holding, selling, or otherwise dealing with gold. On January 19, 1976, Marjorie S. Holt noted for the record a second declaration of interdependence and clearly identified the United Nations as a communist organization and that they were seeking both production and monetary control over the Union and people through international organization promoting the One World Order. See Congressional Record, January 19, 1976, Extension of Remarks. Also see 8 U.S.C.A. 1101, 40, 50 U.S.C.A. 781 and 783. The socioeconomic situation, of course, worsened, as noted in the complaint petition filed in the U.S. Court of Claims, docket number 41-76, on February the 11th, 1976, by 44 federal judges, Atkins et al. Versus United States. Atkins et al. Complained that, quote, as a result of inflation, the compensation of federal judges has been substantially diminished each year since 1969, causing direct and continuing monetary harm to plaintiffs. The real value of the dollar decreased by approximately 34.5% from March 15, 1969 to October 1, 1975. As a result, plaintiffs have suffered an unconstitutional deprivation of earnings, unquote. And in the prayer for relief claimed, quote, damages for the constitutional violations enumerated above measured as the diminution of his earnings for the entire period since March 9, 1969, unquote. Now, you don't have to be too smart to know that it's quite apparent that the persons holding and enjoying offices of public trust and honor and our profit knew of the emergent problem and sought protection for themselves to the damage and injury of the people and children who were classified as a, quote, club that has many other members, unquote, and, quote, have no remedy, unquote, and knowing that, quote, heinous, unquote, acts had been committed, stated that they, judges and lawyers, would not apply the law, nor would any substantive remedy be applied, or checked more or less, but never stopped, quote, until all of us judges are dead, unquote. Such persons fraudulently swore an oath to uphold, defend, and preserve the sovereignty of the nation and several Republican states of the Union and breached the duty to protect the people, the citizens, and their posterity from fraud, imposition, avarice, and stealthy encroachment. See Atkins et al. Versus United States, 556 F2D, 1028, page 1072, 1074. See The Tempting of America, Supra, pages 155 through 159. Also see 5 USCA 5305 and 5335. Senate Report number 93-549, pages 69 through 71. CRS 24-75-101. This is verified in Public Law 94-564. The Legislative History, page 5944, which states, quote, moving to a floating exchange rate for international commerce means private enterprise and not central governments bear the risk of currency fluctuations, unquote. That's us. Now, numerous serious debates were held in Congress, including but not limited to Tuesday, July 27, 1976. And you can see the congressional record for the House, July 27, 1976, concerning the international financial institutions and its operations. Representative Ron Paul, chairman of the House Banking Committee, made numerous references to the true practices of the, quote, international, unquote, financial institutions, including but not limited to the conversion of $27 million in gold contributed by the United States as part of its quota obligations, which the International Monetary Fund, Governor, Secretary of the Treasury. Now, you know what I'm saying here. The governor of the International Monetary Fund is the Secretary of the Treasury of the United States of America. He receives his paycheck from the International Monetary Fund and not from the United States government. Talk about treason. The International Monetary Fund sold this gold. They sold it. See Public Law 94-564. The legislative history is on pages 5945 and 5946. And they sold it under some very questionable terms and concessions. You can also see the Ron Paul Money Book, 1991, by Ron Paul, Plantation Publishing, 837 West Plantation, Clute, Texas, 77531. That last number was the zip code, in case you're still enmeshed in all these USCAs and other things. On October 28, 1977, the passage of Public Law 95-147, 91 statutes, 1227, declared most banking institutions, including state banks, to be under direction and control of the corporate governor of the International Monetary Fund. See Public Law 94-564. And let me read that again for you. On October 28, 1977, the passage of Public Law 95-147, 91 statutes, 1227, declared most banking institutions, including state banks, to be under direction and control of the corporate governor of the International Monetary Fund. See Public Law 94-564, Legislative History, page 5942, United States Government Manual, 1990 and 91, pages 480 through 481, and the Act further declared that, quote, 2. Section 10A of the Gold Reserve Act of 1934, 31 U.S.C. 822 A and B, is amended by striking out the phrase, quote, stabilizing the exchange value of the dollar, unquote, unquote. C. The joint resolution entitled Joint Resolution to Assure Uniform Value to the Coins and Currencies of the United States, approved June 5, 1933, 31 U.S.C. 463, shall not apply to obligations issued on or after the date of enactment of this section, unquote. The international organizations, corporations, and associations had refused to pay their debts and could not pay their debts, and determined that they could pass the loss of their non-redeemable, non-current notes, bonds, and evidences of debt off on others, and thereby crown their fraud with success. Wonder who those others are. You're going to find out. See a letter, October 26, 1989, from the Department of Treasury, Russell L. Monk, Assistant General Counsel, International Affairs, as recorded in the office of the Clerk and Recorder, Baca County, Colorado, at Book 540, page 364. The de facto United States as Corporator, 22 U.S.C.A. 286E, et sequitur, and State, CRS 2436104, CRS 2460-1301, Article 4H, had declared, quote, insolvency, unquote. See 26 IRC 165G 1, UCC 1-201, 23, CRS 3922-103.5, Westfall versus Braley, 10 Ohio 188, 75, MDEC 509, Adams versus Richardson, 337, SW 2nd, or 2D, I should say, SW 2D, 911, Ward versus Smith, 7 Wall, 447. In 1980, Congress passed, among other things, Public Law 96-221, providing for the furtherance and expansion of the profligate rehypothecated debt pyramid scheme and reduced the reserve requirements on transaction accounts to a minimum of 3% per centum to a maximum of 14%. See Depository Institutions Deregulation and Monetary Control Act of 1980, Section 103VE2. Quote, in the United States, neither paper currency nor deposits have value as commodities. Intrinsically, a dollar bill is just a piece of paper. Deposits are merely book entries. Coins do have some intrinsic value as metal, but generally far less than their face amount. In the absence of legal reserve requirements, banks can build up deposits by increasing loans and investments, so long as they keep enough currency on hand to redeem whatever amounts the holders of deposits want to convert into currency. This unique attribute of the banking business was discovered several centuries ago. At one time, bankers were merely middlemen. They made profit by accepting gold and coins brought to them for safekeeping and lending them to borrowers, but they soon found that the receipts they issued to depositors were being used as money, since whoever held them could go to the banker and exchange them for metallic money. Then, bankers discovered that they could make loans merely by giving borrowers their promise to pay banknotes. That's what banknotes are, folks. In this way, banks began to create money. More notes could be issued than the gold and coin on hand because only a portion of the notes outstanding would be presented for payment at any one time. Enough metallic money had to be kept on hand, of course, to redeem whatever volume of notes was presented for payment. Transaction deposits are the modern counterpart of banknotes. It was a small step from printing notes to making book entries to the credit of borrowers, which the borrowers in turn could spend by writing checks, thereby printing their own money. See Modern Money Mechanics, a workbook on deposits, currency, and bank reserves, 1982. Federal Reserve Bank of Chicago, Post Office Box 834, Chicago, Illinois, 60690, pages 3 and 4. What I just read you, ladies and gentlemen, is quoted verbatim from the Depository Institutions Deregulation and Monetary Control Act of 1980, Section 103BE2. Is not temporary. It's a permanent state of emergency and was clearly instituted, formed, and erected within the Union through gross usurpations, abridgments, malfeasance, breach of legal duties, treason, and the continual contrivance, misrepresentation, conversion, fluctuations, fraud, lies, and avarice of the international financial institutions, organizations, corporations, and associations, and secret societies, including the Federal Reserve, their fiscal and depository agent, 22 U.S.C.A. 286D. This profligate practice has led to such emergency legislation as the Public Debt Limit Balance Budget and Emergency Deficit Control Act of 1985, Public Law 99-177, etc. The government, by becoming a corporator, see 22 U.S.C.A. 286E, lays down its sovereignty and takes on that of a private citizen. It can exercise no power which is not derived from the corporate charter. See the Bank of the United States versus Planters Bank of Georgia. 6 L. Ed. 9 Wheat 244, United States versus Burr. 309 U.S. 242. The real party in interest is not the de jure United States of America or state, but, quote, the bank, unquote, and, quote, the fund, unquote. 22 U.S.C.A. 286 et sequitur, CRS 1160-103. The acts committed under fraud, force, and seizures are many times done under, quote, letters of marquee and reprisal, unquote, in effect, recapture under the prize laws of admiralty. See 31 U.S.C.A. 5323, such principles as fraud and justice never, ever dwell, ladies and gentlemen, together. Wingate's Maxims 680, and, quote, a right of action cannot arise out of fraud, unquote. Broome's Maxims 297 and 729. Cowper's Reports 343. 5 Scott's New Reports 558. 10 Massachusetts 276. 38 Fed 800 are too high of a thought concept, as is due process, just compensation, and justice itself. You see, honor is earned by honesty and integrity, not under false and fraudulent pretenses, nor will the color of the cloth one wears cover up the usurpations, lies, trickery, deceits, and treason. You see, when black is fraudulently declared to be white, not all will live in darkness. As astutely observed by Will Rogers, quote, there are men running governments who shouldn't be allowed to play with matches, unquote, and we learned that in Waco, Texas. And it is as applicable today as Jesus' statements about lawyers. The contrived emergency has created numerous abuses and usurpations and abridgments of delegated powers and authority, as stated in Senate Report 93-549. Quote, since March 9th, 1933, the United States has been in a state of declared national emergency. In fact, there are now in effect 4 presidentially proclaimed states of national emergency, in addition to the national emergency declared by President Roosevelt in 1933. There are also the national emergency proclaimed by President Truman on December 16th, 1950. That's December 16th, 1950, during the Korean conflict. And the states of national emergency declared by President Nixon on March 23rd, 1970, and August 15th, 1971. These proclamations give force to 470 provisions of federal law. These hundreds of statutes delegate to the president extraordinary powers, ordinarily exercised by the Congress, which affect the lives of American citizens in a host of all-encompassing manners. This vast range of powers taken together confer enough authority to rule the country without reference to constitutional process. Under the powers delegated by these statutes, the president may seize property, organize and control the means of production, seize commodities, assign military forces abroad, institute martial law, seize and control all transportation and communication, regulate the operation of private enterprise, restrict travel, and in a plethora of particular ways, control the lives of every American citizen. The introduction of that Senate report on page one begins with a phenomenal declaration to wit, quote, "A majority of the people of the United States have lived all of their lives under emergency rule. For 40 years, freedoms and governmental procedures guaranteed by the Constitution have in varying degrees been abridged by laws brought into force by states of national emergency," unquote. Good night, and God bless you all.